I'll take a moment to give a brief overview. We are a voluntary association of local governments. We're one of just 24 COGs in Texas, and our main function is to transcend jurisdictional boundaries to promote sound development and facilitate cooperation among our member governments. Here's our agenda for today. We have three great speakers lined up, so we'll have a Q&A session at the end. Let's go ahead and get started. So for those of you who may not be very familiar with the work of the Trash-Free Waters Project, I'll provide a brief overview of some of our projects and work that we're doing. In 2020, the North Central Texas Council of Governments, with our partners in Houston Galveston Area Council and the Meadows Center for Water and Environment. So we are project partners, and the North Central Texas Council of Governments received an EPA Gulf of Mexico Trash-Free Waters grant to work on establishing a unified coordinated approach to litter abatement and community engagement within the six river basins represented in the Dallas-Fort Worth and the Houston-Galveston regions. Representing over 50% of the state's population, trash reduction and removal efforts in these two regions can have a significant impact on Galveston Bay and the Gulf of Mexico. So here are some of the goals and tasks that are being undertaken as part of the Trash-Free Waters Project. The Trash-Free Texas website is a website that houses an interactive map of adopt-a-spot locations located around the state. The goal is to promote the awareness and use of the Trash-Free Texas website and increase the number of adopt-a-spot locations on the website from as many entities around the state as possible. The Trash-Free Texas website will also house educational content and free downloadable resources for local governments, nonprofits, and others to encourage public engagement. That content will include things like a local government trash reduction and educational toolkit. Another goal of the Trash-Free Waters program is to work with Texas restaurants on a voluntary program to reduce their use of single-use plastic items like straws and utensils. And another component of the project is engaging and educating through initiatives such as a Mayor's Challenge, which is a regional litter cleanup competition, engaging hobby groups such as paddlers, cyclists, or runners in cleanup activities and events. And then that brings us to why we're here today, to promote learning and engagement on topics related to litter and the efforts to keep our waterways clean through informative webinars. So today we're going to be talking about litter and floatables and different ways that they're being addressed around the state. First, I'd like to just go over a few statistics and reasons why these efforts are so important. These first few bullet points are just a few of the litter facts from our friends over at Don't Mess With Texas. Roughly 362 million pieces of litter accumulate on roads in Texas annually. 71% of that litter is considered micro litter, or litter that is 2 inches or smaller. And 25% of the litter on Texas's roads could have been recycled as there were items such as beverage containers and paper products. And all of this roadside litter, along with escape trash and illegal dumping, has a chance of making it into our waterways. The EPA notes that trash, packaging, and improperly disposed of waste from sources on land accounts for 80% of the marine or aquatic debris that is found on beaches during cleanups and surveys. And all of this litter and trash is costly. Many of you are probably already familiar with the 2017 Texans for Clean Water study, which illustrated the costs associated with illegal dumping and litter for our local governments. This study of just 9 cities in Texas, representing 25% of the state's population, found documented expenditures of more than $50 million annually on prevention, education, abatement, and enforcement efforts to address litter and illegal dumping within their communities and waterways. And not only is it costly, but it creates an eyesore. And when it prevents or deters recreational activities, that can also cost communities revenue dollars from folks who don't want to come and tube, kayak, swim, or fish with a bunch of litter and trash. And so the litter and escape trash in the environment, not only are these unsightly, but they also are harmful to the health of our watersheds and the humans and animals that live there. Locally, litter and debris can clog storm drains and contribute to flooding. The litter that then makes its way into our streams, rivers, lakes, or other local water bodies can impact the health of drinking water sources for many Texans and could ultimately find its way to the Gulf of Mexico. And finally, stormwater permits require that floatables be addressed with source and or structural controls. While some permits may incorporate trash provisions in sections of the permit devoted to addressing one of the six minimum control measures, others may include a separate section entirely dedicated to floatables management program. Either way, it is something that must be addressed within the permits. I'm about to turn the presentation over to our first speaker, but I wanted to get everyone warmed up this morning with a few polling questions. Okay. So where does addressing floatables fall as a priority for your municipality or organization? So it looks pretty evenly split between being of high priority or of some concern. Okay, we'll go on to our next question. Is addressing floatables in your stormwater permit? So the answers, responses are yes, they are addressed in one or more minimum control measures. Yes, they are addressed through a floatables management program. No, they're not in my permit, or D, this does not apply to me. All right, we'll go ahead and close this one out. So it looks like for at least half of you, they are addressed in at least one or more of your minimum control measures. So due to a full agenda today, we won't be announcing the speaker bios for our presenters. However, they will be available on the presentation slides that will be posted later for your reference. So I'd like to go ahead and introduce our first speaker, Perry Harts. Perry is the division manager with the City of Frisco. Perry, the floor is now yours.
Well, thank you, and thank you for the introduction. That's a great introduction on trash as being a priority and a problem. And I like how you did that with the poll. You know, one of the things that I kind of miss having meetings in place where we get to see each other face to face is you raise hands, and for those that think it's a high priority and so forth, and we get a feel for the audience and have some time to interact. Your poll there kind of makes up for that shortcoming and doing this as a webinar. So thank you for doing that. But it's a high priority for us and has been for years that we recognize trash as being high priority and being our largest pollutant by volume, by no doubt, by any way you could measure it by volume, it is the number one pollutant. And we've recognized that for years, and we've done programs here and there to help alleviate it. Adopt the Street, I see, is a big help on doing that, and education. But as far as building a device and so forth, we haven't done that until just recently because, you know, the permit requires it. The need for it to have one is in our MS4 permit. We're phase two city, tier four. There's not many people in that group. That's the phase two cities, the smaller cities that are above 100,000. And Frisco was in that. We were a small city when the phase ones were initiated, so we missed that one. But by the time phase twos came out, we were a large city and growing. So there's a few of us in that group where we have to do some device to reduce floatables. Well, when we realized that we had to do this, first step, and we knew this a couple of years before the permit was issued in 2019, that we would have to have a device somewhere. So let me first show you where Frisco is, just in case somebody's outside the Metroplex is not familiar with it. Crysta, do you see my cursor on the screen?
I do.
Okay, thank you. Here's Frisco. We're north of Dallas, north of Plano. There's McKinney and Louisville out here in the colony. So the boundaries of Frisco is 121, Custer, 380 to the north, and 423 to the west. And then here's the Dallas North Toll Road as it comes through Frisco. And then there's Preston Road as it goes through Frisco. Well, one of the sites that was one key feature that I thought was needed for a site is somewhere central to the city. We didn't want something way out on the west edge or east edge of the city that we have to drive there to go look at. If it's in the central part of the city, there's a more opportunities to come check on the device and to do maintenance for it, which we knew such a device would be needed. So we wanted to get something centrally located, and we picked something in the center of the town in between Preston and the toll road in this area here. We also, another key thing is that obviously is one, a creek that has trash in it. And this area upstream has a large retail area and apartments. So it's a lot of, and Preston Road itself, a lot of trash in this channel here. And then another key feature on the location is something that has a downstream benefit. And this one has a downstream benefit of a park, a linear park. And so we picked this location right here at the near the corner of Hickory and Woodstream on this creek here to filter out, collect trash so that there'd be less of it in the park. And we have a lot of linear parks in Frisco. Trash is a big problem in the linear parks. We got trails and so forth going through these riparian areas that, you know, with a lot of bikers, a lot of joggers, runners, and they enjoy these. And the experience is somewhat diminished because of all of the trash that's along the route. So we found this to be a win-win situation. And then on top of that, I live in this neighborhood. So the ability to check on it was quite easy because I can get to it pretty easy. As a matter of fact, I walk this these and run these trails here. So it was a perfect location for us to do it. And there's a pedestrian bridge right here where you can see the trash hung up in the trees on both sides. So it's a good monitoring location. So more specifically, this site was a good because it has good access to a road. You have to have check on these devices frequently and be able to get a truck in there to do maintenance, and have them parking nearby was a big advantage. So this was a perfect site for us. And I think it's important for any prototype site to be able to have it and reach where you can see it quite frequently. So we determined the location. So the next step is determine what to put in. And here's one that approach that we didn't use, but we did this actually before the permit came out, to start looking at ways we could reduce the trash. And a commercial approach was looked at. We hired an engineer to run a modeling, flood modeling, prove that if we had a 18-inch weir here, that's not gonna cause flooding. And they were able to show that we wouldn't have flooding if we put in a weir type device. And so we got some sketches, and you can see even a cross-section view of the things that we would have had to build if we would have taken this approach. And you can see we had to excavate into the creek bed, pour concrete in the creek bed. And a device like this is rigid, it's not portable. And on top of that, to build it, you'd have to divert the creek or do something so that you can pour concrete in the creek bed. And so this wasn't selected. This particular device wasn't selected. And the reason it's not selected is, like I said, we would have had to redirect the creek for the construction and had to remove trees to get our equipment down in there so we could do excavation and digging. Then would require digging in the creek bed and, you know, to help the environment, not tear it up. And so this particular approach wasn't suitable. And so it was rejected for those reasons. And then on top of that, there's maintenance costs with this because the particular one had parts on it that cost $500 with it to replace, and it's inflexible. So if we would have picked this site and it turned out, well, it just doesn't collect trash for whatever reason, or it was just unacceptable to be in that location, we couldn't pick it up and move it. It's there, it's forever. And so the inflexibility destroyed it. So we started with a blank sheet of paper, went to the drawing board to come up with something. And what we saw, rather than building something rigid that would build withstand flood water, which that's something you need to do in the creek, we decided, well, let's have something that would actually fail. And we took the inspiration from street signs that are designed to actually fail and shear off so that, that they don't kill the driver if you run off the road and hit a street sign. We decided the same approach with a shear pin in the middle to break loose whenever we had a great force, flood waters or debris blockage or whatever. So we wanted to build something that's flexible and build it upon something that's at every crossing for the roads in Frisco. Anyway, we got a concrete apron there already. So there's no reason to pour more concrete. We got the concrete there. Let's take advantage of it. So we had to start at the drawing board because we couldn't find a product that actually made that matched that. And so we got our drawing a little bit, narrowed down a little bit more on a swinging gate concept, you know, build a bollard, attach that to the existing concrete, and then the rest of it's all freestanding. You know, it's all built off the bollard and swings. And so the only holes in destruction on the site is to put down the concrete bollard, which has four holes in it to anchor it to the concrete apron. So to do this, we did this all what we call the MacGyver approach. We got parts and things that are just out there. You can get at Walmart or at the Home Depot or at Amazon. And we got all of our parts from those sources there. It's all off the parts items, except for the steel. We did buy the steel from outside of Walmart or obviously. But we got steel. Now, you might think steel, that's the wrong thing for a creek. And it is, but it is great for a prototype. You wouldn't want to, once we have this concept proved, we'll look at other types of materials. But for fabrication, steel is the best. It's easiest to cut, weld, and do all of these things so that we can build this and prove the concept. And then, of course, steel, we have to have it painted. Now, once the concept's proved, we'll like I said, we'll look at the different materials, stainless steel, maybe even aluminum, or even taking steel and doing a powder coating or hot dip galvanized or something like that. But for proving a concept, this is the approach we've taken, this painted steel. And so with the steel, we do have welders that can weld steel, and we took advantage of that capability. And then another off-the-shelf thing that we used was these concrete bumpers. And we use those to channel the water into our gates. So very little destruction here. The holes, like I say, are the bollards. And then we had to have holes for the bumpers, which each have two holes in it. And we just drilled holes in there. So if we had if this site just was unsuitable, if there was just, we just couldn't stay there anymore, we could pack all this up and move it, and only have a few holes to, you know, grout up on the concrete. We could be gone and there'd be no residue left behind, no sign that we were there. And so this is completely movable, and so it was a big approach. And so we got this installed, and let me see if we can, let's see if we can show the, I thought I had video here, but we can, I guess my video is not working, but anyway, if you could picture running water, this is the water runs through here, runs through the bags, and these bags are off the shelf. We got them at Amazon. They are just nylon bags. I think they were sold as equipment bags for baseball players that throw their equipment in. And what we did is got just straps, nylon strap, ratchet them down, and use that. So nothing, it's all, like we said, MacGyver, it's just a approach to materials off the shelf. So here I show that it does break open, that there's a place for four bolts in the middle for it to break. The most we've used is two, and two seems to be the right combination so that when you get enough force, it'll snap and break. And we have collected trash. You know, obviously, we'll collect leaves as well. TCQ has told us that we don't have to separate, which is a good thing. We just have to quantify the amounts that's collected. And so we've done that. We've collected and weighed it, and we've weighed the debris. And so far, just a couple of weeks ago, we put this in November. And so within 6 months' time, we collected over 2,100 pounds. So we've gotten our first ton. Debris collected a few weeks ago, and so and that's what we're doing. We're weighing it, and I'm actually putting it on our annual report. So if this is successful, I think it would somewhat prove that at this point, and thanks to COG, they've come out and got a better drawing than what we had on our whiteboard, and They got the Albert Half to come out and do some dimensions, and I believe this will be available in iSwim. And so, you know, our desire is to make this available to anybody that wants to use it. We'll also see this is scalable, so it could be used in different, you know, different sizes, different size creeks and so forth. And another thought too, what my thought is it costs a lot of money to do floodplain studies. I think we spent almost $10,000 to do a floodplain study to prove it doesn't cause a problem. What we hope is that we won't have to do studies in the future. We can convince our floodplain managers that, yeah, this is going to break away. It's not going to be a problem. We have a flood, and so we don't need to do the study. So the key features are shear pins so that it reduces the flooding, avoid a log jam, debris jam, and the structural requirements are less. If you know it's going to break when the pin snaps, all you have to do is have a structure that's stronger than those pins. So you don't have to get into elaborate calculations on the flow and desire of the creek, the drag of the creek on the bags and other things. And you use the concrete aprons that are already there. Take advantage of that so you don't pour more concrete down in the creek. And the construction doesn't require rerouting the creek. So those are the key features. And so I went through these pretty fast, we'll have time for questions, I believe, at the end, Crysta, and I'll stay on here and watch the chat. So if you got any questions that I might help out on, I'll be here. So let me turn it back over to Crysta.
Great. Thank you so much, Perry. What a great example of some Texas ingenuity to solve a problem. So, So next we're going to have Rick Masters. Rick is a senior environmental scientist with the city of Pasadena. Rick, the floor is now yours.
All right. Good. Thank you very much. I enjoyed listening to Mr. Harts. That's cool. We see very few devices, actually in-stream devices that collect trash. There is actually a pretty good system that is available that the city of Pasadena has used for about 15, 20 years. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about it. This is a device that a guy named Perry Panousis in the Houston area designed probably about 15, 20 years ago. And it's essentially called a Gator. It's a Gator system. And so this is a trash rack that can float and you can attach some other things on it. But anyway, I want to talk a little bit about trash first and what we think about it and how we are trying to tackle the actual problem. As mentioned before, you know, the problem with trash and floatables, you know, obviously is they make their way into Galveston Bay, the Gulf of Mexico. Fortunately, there's a few reservoirs in between you guys and us, but ultimately, you know, waste and debris definitely affects fishable, swimmable, aesthetic qualities in streams, and it's important for us to really try to get a handle on. Especially microplastics have become sort of a problem. So as these plastic bottles and things break down, we're starting to see a new element. You know, is essentially microplastic throughout the world now. And so this is a picture of a Clear Creek, which is a stream quite a bit north of Pasadena. It's sort of the border between Montgomery County and Harris County, which would be where the city of Conroe is and maybe like the city of Houston. So that's kind of the two counties here. But this creek kind of follows that county line. And you can see the amount of trash that is coming from the, you know, the Houston area that get hung up in bridges. And this stuff will eventually make its way into Galveston Bay unless it's actually removed. So the city of Pasadena, unlike the city before, was a phase one MS4. And so they were issued their permit in the 90s. I've been working with them and lots of other cities across the state for many, many years. I've kind of been working in this MS4 permit program since it started. And so the city of Pasadena is situated sort of on the southeast side of Houston, in between Houston and the Bay. And we have Armand Bayou that runs through Galveston and dumps directly into Galveston Bay. So we're sort of the last line of defense for some of the water that gets to the ship channel in the Bay. Now, so as mentioned before, the phase two permittees, only a select few, the tier four folks are now having to deal with floatables. Now, larger cities like Dallas, Houston, Beaumont have all had, these floatable requirements for a long time. And I think what we've done is for a long time is we've looked at these in sort of a strange fashion. We really look at stormwater compliance as what is required. And so, just above where I have this circled, structural controls, it says to the maximum extent practicable. Well, that means that you do everything that's required, but it can also mean that you do a little more than is required. Okay, so what we're talking about in most cities that are required to do floatables monitoring is that they have two locations, right? And that they clean these devices, as necessary, but at least twice a year. So if you look at most phase one MS4s and MS4s that are getting going, they have enough other things to think about that's really what they do. They kind of target that, and then they weigh it up and put it in their annual report. All is well after that. In Pasadena, we've collected a number of these systems over the years, and so we now have seven of these floatable capture gates. And what we're finding is that we are looking at ways to, kind of private partner, team up with our vendor who's provided these to us over the years. We've gotten a grant for a few of them, but we want to devise a system that really looks at going beyond just the minimum. We're obviously far beyond what the minimum requirements are. We're really looking at ways that we could put these things in series and we can utilize them to make a real impact on trash that can get to Armand Bayou. Also, cities have other programs. So we obviously have public education. We have a trash bash once a year where we clean Armand Bayou, and we have volunteer litter programs, just as everybody else, adopt a street, adopt a stream, all these things. But the same can be said about all of those types of programs is those are all intermittent programs. And so unlike, the device that the gentleman before, those things work 24/7. So, and they're in stream, and they're actual structural controls that catch trash all the time. So we are starting to think that is, probably going to be a part of the solution. We got to get beyond, just doing the educational things. But we've got to find a way for municipalities to really take this problem and say, hey, we can actually put together some system to capture as much trash as possible and reduce the amount of trash going to our streams. And so you can kind of see this is a GIS map of our storm sewer system. And you can see we have on this one part of town, we now have about five of these systems. It's a pretty big part of town. This is sort of the southwest part of town. And you can see it's all immediately upstream from Armand Bayou. This brown and pink shaded areas are floodplain. And so that is sort of the floodplain of Armand Bayou. So just upstream of where these things are wet, a lot of these channels, these are channels that go into the natural waterway. And a lot of these channels, some of them are concrete lined. And so if they are concrete lined, then there's a very good opportunity for us to install one of these floatable capture gates. The idea of putting, a couple of capture gates in series, I'm just kind of showing you what we're doing here. And so instead of trying to tackle these giant watersheds all in one device, We found that actually putting multiple devices and breaking these basins down into smaller bite-sized micro basins allows us to essentially put these devices in and collect the trash and not necessarily put too much pressure on one of these devices. And so you can see in this particular diagram, we've got a drainage ditch. This is a concrete line ditch that comes in from like three or four different directions to this intersection, but it all flows according to those arrows and ends up at a very large flowable capture gate that's indicated by the green arrow. So we've got a system that intercepts a branch of the storm sewer system in yellow and one in red. So it's a way to think about, you don't necessarily have to have an industrial solution if you have several solutions. Now, I will say the capture gates that we have are industrial strength. They're stainless steel. They're made of fiberglass grating, which is very cool. And then awesome part of them is that they actually just as mentioned before, they bolt to the side of existing concrete, and they can be taken out, maintained, moved, and they also can float, which is a very key point. And I'll get back to that part, but I want to talk about kind of what we are developing as a plan for the future. Like I said, there's one thing to meet requirements, and was certainly it's a priority to meet permit requirements. And it's obviously, if you're familiar with MS4 permitting, there's a lot of requirements. So I understand that, we can't all focus all of our energies on one item. But what we're trying to do is turn this trash collection business more into a city service than sort of a, kind of a side note. In our permit. And so we have crews from Street and Bridge that clean these systems very frequently. They're inspected monthly. So anyway, what we found is we are going to put together a plan, essentially, a plan to kind of take the map of all the storm sewer systems and identify essentially all the good locations where we could put floatable capture gates. And so these are some of the considerations. We are closer to the coast, so we need to have a place that is not going to entangle, entrain, or capture any wildlife. So we need to be above tidal or above those floodplains. We also need adequate right-of-way. As mentioned, we do have to get in there with equipment. I have some pictures later on how we maintain these things. We do have to get by it near these devices with significant equipment to, clean up trash. And sometimes we can put people in stream as well. Linear reaches with good anchor points. We think, concrete aprons, concrete line ditches. These systems can be installed in earthen natural channels as long as you would put in some type of concrete post such that you could attach it to. So that's sort of our idea of opportunities. And we're using GIS and our common sense to try to put together a list of those locations. And then ultimately, we'll measure the cross-sectional width. We know from our vendor that we pay about $1,000 per linear foot. That includes the design, the construction of it, the installation of it, the whole thing. So for a 10-foot wide, drainage channel, it would be about 10 grand. So the next item that we plan to do at the end of this thing is once we have the whole city kind of figured out, we're going to put together a budget. I mentioned our vendor is Waterway Cleanup Services, Perry. I know they're in the process of becoming a 501c3 not-for-profit. And we're also participating with a couple of good organizations that are involved with HGAC. Like, I have to give a shout out to the newest organization, which is Partners in Litter Prevention, POP. But anyway, recently we had a trash summit, and this is a very new organization, but we're looking for ways to get grants. And that's the key thing, to get more of these systems in place. Like I said, we have a crew of folks that know that this is part of their normal duty. I think that's real important. They know these are city workers, not volunteering my time to go out and look at this. This is an actual city process with a line item with money attached, right? So that's real key, is there has to be a budget if we're going to make this thing work. So this is an example of an opportunity, right? So we have a concrete line channel, a small ditch with some storm sewers coming in. And then you can see we're just upstream of where this little shaded area is, which is would be the actual floodplain. And it would go into the bayou there. So we are essentially circling up areas like this and putting them on our map as we speak. That's the process we're in. And so I've got a few slides that kind of show a few other locations where we have them. And you can see that these are urban channels before they get into really the natural waterway systems. And so next slide, we'll go through these pretty quick so I can get to some of the more important ones. And so this one is kind of interesting. It's located right before the storm sewer system goes underground for a little ways, and then it eventually does enter a natural stream. The cool thing about most of the channels is they are earthen, a lot of them, with a low flow concrete channel. The low flow concrete channels in our part of the world is there for us to be able to remove sediment. We were talking about the Gulf Coast, Houston, Beaumont, Galveston, those kind of areas. We're actually composed of sediment. In prehistoric days, we didn't exist because we needed all of the sediment from the rest of the world to wash down into the Gulf and actually form it. So as a result, since we're sort of flat, sediment does transport in our area and tends to collect in the bottom of our drainage channel. So we end up with these rectangular shaped clean out areas, which are called low flow channels. And that's where we can actually clean sediment in the drier parts of our channels before they go into natural waterways. So this is an example of one of the floatable capture gates with a float system on it. And that's the information for the gentleman that we've worked with for, like I said, about 20 years. He invented this system, much like, I guess, the folks in Frisco's, I know his background was that his family worked in the ship repair business, and they had folks that were complaining about trash in the ship channel. So anyway, this is one of the systems. Okay, so I'm going to show you a few pictures. We're going to go through them pretty quickly. This is another one of our capture gates. Here's one, and you can see that, they work very effectively. And they're on these metal arms that are bolted to the sides of these channels. And so they can actually lift up with the water and fall back down when they have floats upon them. So in terms of the actual hydraulics, you don't have to worry about these things sort of clogging up and breaking away. They do have shear pins. They are designed to fail as well, but they tend to float up and let the bulk of stormwater go under them and capture floatables and then, slam back down at the bottom of the creek. It's just another picture of one. You can see the arms a little better in this one. Here's an example of some of the materials that we collect at some of these capture gates. And you can see they, range from normal trash all the way to fire extinguishers. Okay, and another part of this is we install signs that really talk about what these capture gates are, so that the public can actually see that these devices are there to collect trash, which we think is a good educational activity. It may seem like I'm rushing through here, but I did see Krista's face. So I only have a few minutes left, so I want to get to the important part. But this is also, we've noticed these things are strong enough to catch entire trees. The picture on your left was a small oak tree that washed off the bank of one of these streams. during a heavy downpour, and this gate actually took this tree like a champ, as I would call it. It captured the whole tree, and just downstream from this gate is an underpass, a box culvert, which, once in there, becomes a real maintenance problem, collects sediment, and can actually lead to flooding problems. So we think that actually these floatable capture gates do more flood prevention than hydraulic damage. Anyway, the next picture is one of our newer capture gates, and you can see it's real clear how these low flow concrete channels work. So I wanted to get through that so that I didn't get cut off at the end. But essentially, one of the pictures on the left there, you can see our crew actually in the ditch cleaning out one of those floatable capture gates. And the crew drives around with essentially a dump truck and a grade awl or backhoe, and they just lift the gates out of the way, and the equipment picks it up and puts it in the dump truck. In this case, they were actually cleaning the entire ditch, because we have found that these things also collect quite a bit of sediment upstream of them. And you can also put, we've experimented with thoughts of putting booms on these systems as well to capture hydrocarbons, since they float, or they're designed where they can float. A lot of our systems, we've taken the floats off because, typically the water doesn't necessarily get out of these things for most events. And so we can capture most of the trash without them floating, but we do occasionally we will float them. And you can see in the last picture, we've got some construction debris trapped there as well. But we just wanted to talk about the concept that, there are requirements and permits, and we, we're all about, meeting requirements and trying to find low cost ways of doing things. Like being inventive is the way to go. And I want to say that I have to give credit to Period Waterway Cleanup Services, because once again, he was just a guy that saw a problem and dreamed up something that works really well. So this is, in kind of in contrast to the previous presentation, this is a commercially available type system. So if you find yourself in a situation where you want to add some things to your system, this will be a good option. But also, like I said, we're hoping to have our plan done in terms of a total plan. That way we can put together a capital improvement project kind of budget, and then also really go after some bigger grants that say, we're gonna go after some really large numbers so that we can take care of a whole city at once, and maybe kind of model this thing as this is a way to really capture trash and floatables before they get to recreational streams. Anyway, with that said, I appreciate the opportunity to kind of talk to you guys. Any questions?
We'll go ahead and hold questions to the end.
All right. Good deal.
So once again, thank you for that presentation and a great look at the solutions that the city of Pasadena is working on. So our final speaker for this morning is going to be Wayne Tschirhart from the city of City of San Antonio. He is a senior technical engineer with the San Antonio River Authority. And Wayne, the presentation is yours.
All right, thank you. Thank you for having us. So we started down this road a few years back because, like everybody else, we have problems with trash in the waterways. Our cleanup crew along the San Antonio River was putting in a lot of hours and time and equipment to collect trash along the streams. It affects our impact or our riparian habitat and our riparian experience for the people that are hiking along our creeks. And like a previous speaker said, it impedes the recreational use of the parks along the waterways in the San Antonio area. So the San Antonio River Authority with a took on a feasibility study probably about 2015, and they borrowed a trash loading study from the city of Los Angeles, California. They used that to calculate trash loading in the water in the watersheds and identified and prioritized 33 sites for potential installation of trash collection systems. And then they evaluated a bunch of different types, the inlet controls, the inline controls, into pipes, nets, and da-da-da. And they ultimately selected two devices that they wanted to try out in our streams. Now, our streams, we live in a fairly, in South Central Texas, we have a lot of terrain differences here. So our streams tend to run fast. They tend to be meandering. And they tend to be ephemeral, so they're dry most of the year, and they're only really flow when rains come. So ultimately, they decided to try two devices. They wanted to try the band-along litter trap, which is up the upper photograph. It's a floating trash capture device with a cage in there, and they wanted to try the StormX trash nets, which you see at the bottom photograph, which is a concrete weir wall with bags attached to it. The first site they selected was this creek, Rockwood Creek, which is a concrete trapezoidal channel to put the trash nets in. They felt this was straight. It was perfect for that design. And so they installed these things in the stream, and they tend to work fairly well. I mean, they're basically a first flush trash collection device, and anything above that weir wall, it just overflows. These are a first flush device, and so far we've captured a lot of thatch. We think that there's some folks upstream that are dumping their yard clippings over their fences. That's the only place we can figure out where this stuff is coming from, but we pick up lots of thatch with this device. This just shows the maintenance. We have a boom crane or boom lift. We basically unbolt these bags from the collars. We lift them up, they haul them off and dump them, and they weigh them. And then they put a new set of bags on the device. The second site they selected was a creek in San Antonio on the west side called Alazan Creek. This creek is a big watershed. It's a trapezoidal earthen channel that was sort of modified by the Corps and by the Corps of Engineers in the 1950s, 1960s. And so they wanted to put the band along in this site. And so we had a super band along designed. This is actually the second version of it. The first version was destroyed right after we installed it, and we had a high flow. The flow completely dismantled the device. So this is the second one. And so as you can see from the photo, the black booms are the trash guiding device as water moves through the system. And then it also has four steel cables that are anchor this thing in place to keep it from drifting from side to side, or if the black booms actually were to be come loose, the device would not continue to go downstream. And this one, once again, we have the boom crane or the boom forklift. We lift the baskets out of the device, put them on a trailer, weigh them. And the slide and the picture on the left shows one of the problems that we've been having with this device is that it collects, once again, this device collects a lot of thatch because the city of San Antonio mows this channel and leaves that thatch on the ground. And so we end up collecting a lot of it in this device. And it also collects on the anchoring cables, which causes its own set of problems. So using from these two devices, we've learned some vital information. One, do your own groundwork. Don't borrow trash loading studies from other jurisdictions, because everybody's different. Every community is unique, and you really need to know where this trash is coming from, not just the fact some generic watershed loading data. So loading data is important, and don't use other people's studies. Another thing we learned real quick is communication is important. We were working really closely with the city of San Antonio on both of these devices. The team that was managing this project really didn't have much contact with the local property owners, and they came out of the woodwork really quick once we started installation. So you need to work with the adjacent property owners for these kinds of devices. The community and education to local groups is really important. Another thing we learned is nothing is vandal proof. What you're seeing in the photographs or the trash net, the trash bag or trash nets, the bottom is our second solution. The original trash nets came with a nylon like zip tie type thing to close the bags. Those were stolen. Then we replaced it with the cables you see in the bottom picture, and then those were stolen for some reason. And then our final solution, which has seems to have held for at least 3 years now, is putting this angle iron on there with lots of bolts, so they have to sit there and fiddle with every nut, and that is stuck, and they haven't stolen that one. And just when you think you've seen it all, with the band along device, somebody decided to start a fire, and it destroyed the boom, trash collection boom. So nothing is vandal proof is our lesson that we've learned out of this. And so you have to be a plan for that and fund for that. And water always wins. So this is a photograph of the second generation band along at the top. We're still having problems with it. These streams flow fast, they flow deep. We did a structural analysis on the second generation of the band along, engineering is based on assumptions, and not all assumptions are valid. So what we think is going on here is, one, the weight of all the wet thatch, we sampled it at about 150 pounds per cubic foot. This device constantly has a problem with sinking into the flood. This flood in this creek, the flow in this creek is really high, probably higher than they modeled it or simulated it when they first started down this road. We don't really catch a lot of trash in this situation. It just sort of bounces over the booms, gets caught in the turbulence, and we fill with thatch. The bottom picture shows the destruction of the first generation of the band along. The force of the stream just completely dismantled it and ripped the seams apart. And even with the second generation, we still have problems. We have to inspect it on a monthly basis to make sure we don't have any stress fractures and cracks in the structure. And finally, I mean, we've gotten to the point where we've come to the conclusion that really, for us, engineering is not the answer. I mean, these two devices were on the order of $750,000 to install them. We had a third trash net device planned that was another $250,000 to install. But immediately upon talking with the community, the community locals came out and basically killed that project at the onset. We can't deploy enough of them to really deal effectively with the trash problem. And so we've gone back to a don't mess with Texas type campaign, educational campaigns and community awareness and those kinds of efforts to try to deal with the cash problem or the trash problem, not the cash, well, the cash problem too. Okay.
That was
so cool. Thank you for having us. We always enjoy talking about these things. And
Well, thank you once again for your presentation, Wayne. So we are going to do another two quick polls. So before today, had you considered an installed or engineered solution to floatables, or do you already have one in place? All right, so we have a good amount of answers here. All right, so we'll go on to our next and final question. What resources do you use when designing or looking for a trash capture device? So we're hoping we could kind of share some ideas. And, you know, obviously a webinar like today is a great opportunity to learn about different devices that are available, but we just want to see what else you guys are looking to whenever you need to install something or design something. Give it a few more seconds. So we'll go to our Q&A session. We're actually doing really fantastic on time. So we'll spend about 20 minutes or so on questions. If you have one for any of our panelists, please go ahead and type them in the chat now. Just as a reminder, please put your name and entity that you're from first, so that way we know who to address when answering the question. And if we end up not having time to answer any of the questions, we'll try to follow up with you later. And also, please feel free to, if you feel comfortable, unmute your line and you can also announce your question.
Hi, Crysta, this is Tamara. Did you need me to help you with the questions?
That would be great. I'm catching up on the chat now.
Yeah, okay. So going back to Perry, there was a question for Perry about how often do they have to empty or clean the bags?
The driver on that is the rainfall frequency, which recently has been like every other day. But yeah, after every major event, we'll collect enough left trash to pick it up. And during dry periods, we've gone a month without having to empty.
Okay, and then another one for Perry was, what was the total installation cost? And I think Perry, you replied to that it was less than $4,000. Did you want to expand on that at all?
That's a material cost. Yes, we spent less than $4,000 in materials. So, but we do have a lot of labor involved because, you know, we were making it up as we went. But that's the cost of materials is less than $4,000.
Okay. And then Julie had asked about using this concept for a storm drain outfall. And I think you suggested that it might work, but would not suggest for something so small unless the water runs continuously.
And for something that small, some of the other devices might work well. If the configuration is right, the Pasadena approach might work better. You know, if you got those sidewalls there. Ours seems to work well for our environment where we got don't have concrete walls. We have concrete aprons at the road crossings, but our channels are been maintained. The riparian areas have been maintained as natural, and so we don't have a lot of concrete out there to attach to other than the apron.
Okay. I think that was all the questions that I saw for Perry. Aaron had asked a question of Wayne about looking at a trash wheel solution, similar to what the city of Baltimore has deployed. And it looks like Wayne replied to that, that they did look at that. Wayne, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, we looked at that one. I mean, it's an awesome device, but like we found with the band along and any of these floating devices, they need to be in waters that are like laminar, like almost like a lake outlet. And I think that one's a river outlet, but that's a very calm river, in that part of the country. And we looked at it, and then we were reading an article, and I think we saw it was $1 million a year maintenance. And we said, yeah, okay, no. And that one, the size on that one was way too big for anything that we have in the sizes of our creek. So we ruled that one out, even if we scaled it down.
Okay, great. Thanks, Wayne. And I'm not sure who this question is for, but Zachary wanted to know, are cleaning maintenance costs factored in as a city budget item, maybe for all of you to address, or covered by grant funding? In general, where are those funds coming from? And is there an estimated annual cost for cleaning of each collection system?
Yeah, for the city of Pasadena, there is a maintenance costs associated with cleaning those things for sure. We have people and equipment that go out and pick them up. And we also have a inspection once a month by the folks that actually created those systems. Perry will go out and actually take a look at each one of them once a month and make sure that there's no, fractures or problems or, little parts that we have to replace. But for the most part, I would say that you're talking about, a $15,000 to $20,000 kind of effort, if I had to guess, in terms of maintenance of the seven systems that we have right now. We plan to expand that, and hopefully we can, continue to, grow the system.
We haven't received any grant for maintenance. We've just done it with our crews. And so far, we're able to do it within everything else that we got going. But if we're going to put more of these in, we need to take we'll have to put at least one more in because of our permit. we'll need to look at the hours they put in and see if we do need some help or help with the crews or help maintaining them.
Yeah. And
okay.
For Sarah, I mean, all of our trash maintenance is budgeted within our river cleanup crews. So I don't have a specific value on them. We clean them within 14 days after every flow event. But I would have estimated this probably on the $50,000 a year for all of them, just for the trash devices. And then it's probably considerably more for the crew, for the manual pickup that we have to pick up along the river, because we hire that out, and that's all coming from Sarah's budget.
Okay, great. Thank you all. The next question we had was for Rick. What was the different sizes or configurations of meshes or screens used on your devices?
And I want to let Perry answer some of these, because that's real specific to the design of the system. But I know he designs each one custom for the actual crossing that you're looking at. So maybe if Perry, if you want to, if you could chime in, maybe you could actually answer that.
Yes, good morning. This is Perry with Waterway Cleanup Services. Do we have any questions?
Yes, they do. They had a question on the actual size of the mesh and different configurations that you can put together. And I'd mentioned that you kind of design them for each situation, but maybe you could talk a little bit about the screen themselves.
Absolutely. Okay, so of course, as mentioned, each system is custom built according to the waterway itself. It actually really depends on how much foliage does fall into these stormwater waterways. As you know, the more foliage, dead plant life does tend to clog up quicker. So the systems, basically, they're built out of aluminum, stainless steel, and fiberglass. That's it. Everything is non-corrosive. We could even experiment, as we have started experimenting, with copper as well, just for the safety of, let's say, if you have a system in a black water instance where you have possible sewage. We know, as a natural deterrent for bacteria, when you want to service these systems, and they're all very lightweight systems, they're extremely durable, but you still have to apply a lot of manual labor to get down there. But so currently what we have right now is all the systems are stainless steel. The rods, the containment systems right now, they're acting as buffering systems also for hydrocarbons. And how that works is we found that you could have actual foliage that falls into the stormwater areas. The systems are capturing these along with trash, and all the dead foliage turns black from hydrocarbons. So it actually is kind of a natural buffering system as well. And they're pretty indestructible. We have had a couple of cases when we first started building these things out. We were testing the waters, let's say, when we did have a tree or two hit a couple of them. And we since have rebuilt them and made them much stronger. And what we found is that the systems not only capture trash, hydrocarbons, and contain silt, keeping the silt from actually flowing down into estuary areas or watersheds.
Hey,
but
Perry,
we've also found, yes. This,
what I think the original question was kind of, what are some of the sizes? How wide can you go, and what's the normal, per square inch, what's the screen usually made of?
Well, the screen is usually stainless steel.
Uh-huh.
And there's no limit to the width. So I'm kind of intrigued to the San Antonio devices that are being used. And I think that's just absolutely awesome. San Antonio is a beautiful city, as all cities are. But I do really enjoy watching people come up with devices and systems in maintaining the watersheds. But what we did notice is that when we first started with these systems many years ago, it was a simple solution to use a netting system, just like what is currently being used in multiple areas. But we had environmental people did question them whether or not we were catching wildlife. And so that was one of the problems that we faced. And we realized that the solution was to put these stainless steel systems. And it's kind of difficult. It's basically a gate system that flows. It's when it does get filled up, it does readjust itself. It's not just something you just throw in there and just attach to the waterways. There's engineering involved in this as far as the flow of water. And they are monitored every month. And sometimes we do go out there for fun because these are our babies. And so what we do is we go out there and we inspect them. And we do free inspections multiple times with the city of Pasadena just because we get something out of this as well. And we found that these systems are literally indestructible. They are made of non-corrosive materials. They're modular systems, so you can actually attach anything you want to them. And pretty much, I mean, they're just very simple systems with a little bit of engineering involved in them.
Okay, thank you so much for sharing that with us.
Absolutely.
I believe that wraps up all the questions that we have in the chat. And I don't see anybody's hand raised for additional questions. So we'll go ahead and move on to a few resources that we would like to highlight. So the Stormwater BMP Library is organized by general topic, making it easy to search for specific items for your individual situation. We do have some pollution prevention and green infrastructure solutions in this library. So when you have a chance, go ahead and check it out. It is linked there on the slide. So our Water for North Texas online library is an online resource of basically all things water related on a regional, state, and national level. You can find helpful social media toolkits, case studies from the North Central Texas Council of Government region, and plenty of other great items that are located here. And the standard drawings, the update for the standard drawings for the Public Works Construction Standards North Central Texas 5th edition is slated to be released in September. And so these standard drawings will be sent out as an amendment to the Construction Standards 5th edition. Currently, there's two trash screens that are in there. They have one that's a small vacation and then one very large one that are pictured there on the slide. So the Public Works Council was interested in adding the City of Frisco's design to give an affordable application for medium-sized streams, and have worked with Half Associates to create a standard drawing based on the one that Perry and his team have built. And again, this will be slated for release in about the September timeframe. And linked on the slide is where you can go to purchase the construction standards. If you have any further questions about this, please reach out to Olivia Kale at her email address there on the screen. And I'd like to put in a quick plug for the North Texas Community Cleanup Challenge, much like a mayor's challenge that we'll be holding as part of the Trash Free Waters Project. The North Central Texas Community Cleanup Challenge is a regional challenge slated for this September and October. So if you or your community are interested in participating, getting involved is very easy. So just follow the four simple steps outlined here on the slide, and then you are on your way to making a difference with cleaning up litter. To learn more about the challenge, you can visit the website that is linked there on the slide. Or you can reach out to me after the webinar with any questions you may have. And of course, I wanted to highlight the bi-monthly newsletter that we are putting together for the Trash-Free Waters North Central Texas region. It will contain featured articles, upcoming events, legislative updates, and partner resources. The last issue was at the beginning of May, and you can view past issues on our project website, which is linked on the page, or linked on the contact and connect slide coming up here in a few slides at the end of this presentation. And the link here on this slide is to subscribe to this newsletter. And finally, just as a reminder that today's presentations will be posted along with a recording of today's webinar on our website. A link will also be provided in a follow-up email in the coming days. If you are joining us today but you didn't register beforehand, please go ahead and email me if you would be like to be added to the follow-up emails. You can also find a recording of a previous webinar we have done, the Trash-Free Waters webinar, Connecting Volunteers with Litter Cleanup Locations, that was held back in January on our project webpage right here. And I would like to give a great big thank you to everyone for joining us today. We really hope that you've enjoyed it and were able to take away something valuable. Here is the contact information for the North Central Texas Council of Government staff that work on the Trash-Free Waters project. If you have questions and want to reach out to any one of us, there's our contact information, as well as some of our social media accounts if you would like to connect with us that way. And I just once again want to say thank you to our presenters for sharing all of your projects and experience with us today. We appreciate it. And that would conclude today's webinar.